know you make a way. And I don't always understand, I don't always get to see, but I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. You make mountains move, you make giants fall. You use songs of grace to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, and I will preach to my doubts. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. I am standing on your word, calling heaven down to earth. You will fight my enemies, and this will end in victory. And I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. You make mountains move, you make giants fall.
Tell me, when are you going to have a child? You're getting older. And it was a lot of pressure on me. I always felt like, oh, I'm 21, I'm 22. I have so much more ahead of me. But then I turned 29 and then I'm like, oh, maybe we should think about having a child. Actually, I started at 27. And we actually were able to get pregnant right away. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So unfortunately, after that first pregnancy, 2 months in, Heidi had a miscarriage.
Yeah, and that was tough. We spent years trying to get pregnant, and it was just not happening. So finally, I went to the doctor, and then they diagnosed me with polycystic ovarian cyst, and that just makes it a lot more difficult to get pregnant because it makes you infertile. And so after that, it was just all downhill because we just didn't know what to do. So I was driving to work. I finally got to work and I finished my prayer before I got off the car. And I'm like, well, God, whatever happens, but you know, I'm just talking to him like, this is not cool. I closed the door, I was walking to my job, and all of a sudden I felt like the Holy Spirit come down and ask me, do you have faith? And my answer was, yeah, but you know, it's not that easy. And it said, no, but do you have faith? And I said, Yes, I do. And then I got home from work, and I just had this huge urge of, okay, you need to take a pregnancy test to make sure. And I was just ready to be let down again, to see that pregnancy test say negative. And when it was positive, I couldn't believe it. I just could not believe it. I was crying of so much joy, but of course I remembered that I had miscarried, so I wondered if this would end up like that. There and then I got on my knees and I prayed, and I just thanked him for this little moment. I thanked him for that moment, and I prayed that this would be a successful pregnancy, and it was. I guess just keep having faith in the Lord, because everything he does is perfect. And even though we may not understand that now and it hurts deep inside, it makes sense later on. For me, I never stopped holding the Lord. I always kept holding to hope and faith. And I just would say, the same thing for someone going through the same thing as we are, to just keep having hope and faith, because everything God does is perfect.
Hello and happy Mother's Day, GV Christian moms. You know, when our kids were young and they were in the house, my nickname was Mom, but my real name was Mom, 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 Mom. And if you're a mom, you know that is the truth. That is how they get your attention. So if you would all do me a favor and bow your heads with me, I'm going to pray for all of our GV Christian moms. So our gracious Heavenly Father, you are the source of our comfort and strength. Lord, I know that there is pain associated with Mother's Day for some. Some of the women listening to this prayer right now are in pain because it's Mother's Day. Some have lost their beloved mom. Some have lost a beloved child. Some are estranged from their child or children. And some have never had the opportunity to have a child in their home. Lord, I pray that you would turn their pain into peace, comfort, and joy in you. Lord, I pray that your powerful presence would be made known to every woman listening to this prayer. I pray that their self-worth wouldn't be tied up in the word mother, but it would be tied up in you, their Lord and Savior. Lord, help us to change our perspective and see our life the way that you see it. For I know when I change the way I look at things, the things that I look at in my life change. Your word asks us to do what we can do, not what somebody else can do, but what we can do. We're not to compare ourselves with somebody else's strengths, but you ask us to do what we can do. And Lord, I pray that we would be faithful to do what we can and not begrudge what we cannot do. Lord, help us to keep our focus on you and not compare ourselves to others. Lord, I pray that you would be with the stressed out mom who's trying to do it all and is perfectionistic, and help her to be the best mom that she can be and to just relax in her motherhood. Lord, I pray that you would be the mom who's hurting or lonely today because of the circumstances in her life. I pray that you would be with her and empower her. Lord, I pray for the mom who's worried about the condition of her house, about the dust and the undone chores in her house. Help her to know that you are more concerned with her heart than you are with her house. And Lord, I pray that you would help her to see her house in the light of eternity, where the dust and the undone chores don't matter. And Lord, I pray that you would help each woman to emotionally relax and not be so hard on themselves. I know that was something I struggled with when our kids were in our home, and I pray that you would help these moms to know everything's going to be okay and to just relax in you. I pray that you would Help each woman to find joy and contentment right where she's at. And not saying, oh, I could be that way if I was over there. But Lord, your word tells us to find joy and be content right where we're at. Ephesians 2:10 says that you created us to do good works. And Lord, I pray that you would help every mom, no matter what's going on in their life, no matter what stage they're in, but to focus on the good works that you have for them to do. And Lord, I pray each woman listening to this prayer will recommit her life to doing good, finding joy, and not comparing herself to anyone else. May every woman hearing this prayer realize that her life is written in chapters and the end of her book is not written yet. Lord, we thank you for all that you are going to do in every mom's life. I pray a special blessing over them. May they receive these words in this prayer. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
for our King soon returning.
Hallelujah.
As we hold to this assurance, Spirit come.
Happy times, whether it's crazy times, whether it's chaotic times, whether it's sad times, whether it's in the waiting times, we're gonna worship right in the middle. How we give you praise, Lord. We love you, Lord. Thank you for your presence in whatever space we are in. Lord, thank you for your presence. You are worthy of our praise. And it is in your name, Jesus, we pray and we worship. And everybody said a good amen. Amen. Praise the Lord, Jesus. Let's give God a praise. We love you, Lord.
Hey, church. My name is Dylan, and I'm excited that we get to continue to be the church, that we get to continue to meet, whether it's online or in person, to worship God together. So thanks for being here. Right now, GV Marriage is offering an incredible opportunity to invest into your marriage with small groups happening monthly starting in June, plus creative dates to empower you and your spouse to spend quality time together. In the small groups, they'll be going through a curriculum based on grace, that our marriages may be based on a foundation of choices of grace. So I want to encourage you, get signed up today. You can go online to gvchristian.com/events, or you can scan that QR code on the back of many of the chairs in the room. The cost is $160 a year, which is just a little bit more than your average Netflix membership. And we want to encourage you, take this opportunity because your marriage is worth it. GV Women wants to bless all of our single moms out there to a night of fun and of free dinner. Kids programs will be available that night so you can bring your kids and they'll have an incredible program that they get to hang out with and have fun in as well. But for you, we want to provide free dinner and just some fun activities on May 24th at 6 p.m. right here at the church. If you're a single mom whose kids are still in the home, we want to invite you to sign up at gvchristian.com/events. Right now though, I wanna say a quick shout out. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there, the aspiring mothers, the soon to be mothers. We are excited to celebrate with you, and there's so many things that children love about their moms.
I love my mom because she hugs me. She got me a chicken nugget. I love my mom because she gives me kisses.
Because she thinks I'm cute.
Paul sings songs to me.
When I broke my toys, my mom helped me fix them.
She helps me go to bed, and I love her because she's the best mom ever.
I love my mommy because she brings me to the park.
I love my mommy because she helps me get my snacks.
I love my mom because she gives me hugs and kisses.
I love my mom because she's the best in the whole wide world.
I love it when you cuddle with me. Happy Mother's Day, Mommy.
Hey, GV Christian, I am so glad that you have joined us here this Mother's Day weekend. A lot of exciting things happening here at GV Christian Center. We're going to have a word of prayer in just a moment for the message and for our time together online. So no matter where you're gathering, I'm so thankful that you're here. You're going to discover whether you are mom or not, that God has something for you this weekend. Now, this week is Law Enforcement Week. And in our prayer, as we pray for the message and for God just to speak to us through his word, we're gonna pray for those who are first responders. I am so thankful, and on behalf of all the GV Christian Center family, we are thankful for those of you who are first on the scene. You are first responders. And you are living under more scrutiny than you ever have. And in the split second decisions that you have to make, we are thankful for you because you protect us day and night. For those of us that sleep at night, we are thankful. We can sleep in peace knowing that our neighborhoods are protected because of you and you're there. So thank you very much. Let's pray together. So Father, we pause just a moment and we ask for your protection upon every man and every woman who are on the front lines. Would you be with them? And in those split-second decisions that only you can understand, those of you on the front lines, we ask that you would give incredible wisdom and direction and help. And we pray when they're living under such scrutiny that you would just be with them with your peace and with your strength. Now, Father, we thank you for your powerful word. You have a word for us this weekend, and we are grateful for it. In your name we pray, amen. Turn your Bible, scroll in your mobile device. If you'd like to join us to do so, to Genesis chapter 29. I've heard this story countless times. Maybe you have as well, or maybe a twist on it, or maybe this story sounds familiar. It's a young woman. And she has the same hopes and dreams that most young women have. To have purpose and meaning in life, to have a vision for the future, to be loved and to be accepted just the way she is. Maybe to have a family one day, if that's her desire, with children that she could be a mom to. And that was the hope someday. She was called and labeled by just about everyone to be physically unattractive. To her, someone else was always more attractive, better looking, better figure, more charismatic. This young woman, she was rejected by her dad. And what security that she should have had in a loving home was absent. And she ended up being used by her biological father to advance his own financial prosperity. She was not the first choice of the man she ended up marrying. She became pregnant and hoped that her husband just might begin to love her. And it was not to be. She was just used for sex. By a husband who didn't love her, she was trapped and she didn't know how to escape. To add insult to injury, her sister was stunning, beautiful, captivating. And her husband desperately wanted to be married to her sister instead of her. She would eventually have one baby after another, with each one hoping, maybe now he will love me. Until she finally gave up ever being loved by her husband. This is a true story. So happy Mother's Day, everyone. But here's the good news. There's a happy ending to this true story. And so we're going to talk about that happy ending in just a moment, because this true story is a story of a woman by the name of Leah. Her husband was the grandson of Abraham. His name? Jacob. And life was far, and what just the description I've given to you, it was far from being fair to Leah. Anybody like this guy, her husband, from what I've just said? Me neither. He was a con man, and the con man was conned. And this is the Jacob of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And it's amazing how God can use real jerks to fulfill his plan and his purpose. Don't be surprised when you encounter a real jerk who calls themselves a Jesus follower. Because a person can call themselves anything they want to be and still be a real jerk. But today, our focus is on Leah and not Jacob. And the remarkable happy ending that God gave this mom, this woman that God considered beautiful. She was found worthy of being in God's eternal word as having great significance for all of eternity. Amazing. And I believe this. I think if you could somehow transport Leah, somehow if we could do that, some kind of a time machine. I know it's weird, but if we could somehow do that to transport Leah to our time before she would realize there was going to be a happy ending, she would be like so many today who have been told that you're unworthy, that you're not good enough, you're not pretty enough, you're too much of a sinner. And if you were to ask her if she'd like to go to church, she might say, or more likely think, both genders, but in this case, Leah, she more likely would think what so many think and tell themselves today. I don't think God would love me the way that I am. I am already burdened enough with life, and I don't need another rejection. So I'm going to stay away from God. Jesus came to tear down every kind of wrong thinking just like that. The Bible says this, that Christ came to reconcile us to him, restore our relationship with God. Leah's story is found in Genesis chapter 29 through 49, and it is one of the most bizarre and strange stories found in the Bible. Which is what I love about God's word. What I love about God's word is that it doesn't hide anything to make people look better. It just reveals the story exactly the way that they were in this broken and hurting world, which is why the Bible says about itself, God says, look, 2 Timothy 3, it says, look, all scripture from Genesis to Revelation is inspired by God. So we look at the story of Leah, this incredible, bizarre, and even strange story. And God tells us, look, this is useful for teaching what is true and to make us realize what's wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we're wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. Now, back to Leah. Here's the first description we learn of Leah. Genesis 29, verse 17. Leah, or Leah, had weak eyes. But Rachel, her sister, had a lovely figure and was beautiful. It's like, ouch. Her Hebrew name means tired or weary or even possibly, you ready for this one? Wild cow. Her sister Rachel, her name means you. It's a positive name of grace and of beauty. And when Leah first became pregnant with a husband who didn't love her or didn't want her, she gave birth to a son. And it says this, Genesis 29, she named him Reuben, for she said, it is because the Lord has seen my misery. Surely my husband will love me now. By all accounts, she is a hurt woman, shamed and depressed. Reuben's name means behold a son. And in that culture, to give birth to a son was the pinnacle for a woman. It was just the culture a few thousand years ago. And it meant the family could be sustained. That was their thinking. Daughters would leave the home. Sons would stay to carry on and help with the family business, usually agriculture. Well, she has another son, Simeon. His name means hearing or heard. Let's read that. It says, she conceived again, and when she gave birth to a son, she said, because the Lord heard that I am not loved, he gave me this one too. So she named him Simeon. Genesis 29, verse 34. Again, she conceived, and when she gave birth to a son, she said, now at last, my husband will become attached to me because I have borne him three sons. So his name was Levi. His name means attached. Verse 35, she conceived again. And when she gave birth to a son, she said, this time I will praise the Lord. So she named him Judah. Then she stopped having children. And everybody said, hey, amen. It's like, well, his name Judah, it means praise. We just read that. This time, she says, I will praise the Lord. That says it all. And this is really the first lesson. We're going to talk about some lessons that we can learn from this true story. Why? Because she is learning, like every single one of us need to learn to do. She is learning to turn to God for help and strength just to help her get through. So here are a few lessons from Leah. And these lessons have to do with what Leah knows now, but she didn't know then. That's important to understand. And you know what those lessons, it's the same as what you will know then on the other side of eternity that you may not realize now. But the sooner that you realize these lessons now, the better off every single one of us are going to be. So here's the first lesson. There is a God-sized hole in your heart that only Jesus can fill. Only Jesus can fill. Every single person in the story of Leah, her sister, her husband, her dad, everyone is trying to find some kind of satisfaction, meaning and purpose in life, happiness, inner peace, in their own way instead of in God's way. Listen very carefully. There is no person on the planet designed to meet your every need or that will make you happy all the time. That only belongs to Jesus. There is no possession, there is no position, there is no amount of fun or partying that can ultimately give you what you're looking for out of life. Soleil, at first, she tries to fill that hole with a husband who would not love her. Eventually, he would. That's the happy ending. We'll get to it. But it would be a long time. Now, the Bible says this in Romans chapter 1, that every single one of us is born with an innate sense and awareness that there is a God. Every culture, every period of history bears that out. And you have to work really hard to shut that down. And a choice of your will. But it didn't work then, and it doesn't work now, and it never will. Because every single one of us have a choice if we're going to seek to know more about who God really is, or the choice is to do life our own way. And we can fill that God-sized hole with all kinds of things and stuff. And it might seem to satisfy for the moment, but here's the problem. It doesn't last. So Leah tried to fill it with a husband, more sons. Not bad things at all, but they didn't last. Now, got some news for you. She would go on to have two more sons. Issachar and Zebulun. Verse 19. Again, Leah conceived and bore a sixth son to Jacob. God has given me a good gift, she said. This time my husband will honor me because I've borne him six sons. And she named him Zebulun. She slipped back into her old habits and her old thinking. So easy to do that. Now, she would have one daughter. Her name would be Dinah. But let's move forward to that happy ending. Here's the second lesson. God built his kingdom through her. And he's building your kingdom, at least that's God's desire, to build his kingdom through you. Your life cannot be measured within the time span of a few decades that you are on this earth. Your story, like Leah's, is intertwined with God's story of salvation. The priestly line would come through her son, Levi, her third son. From there would come Moses and Aaron and the first five books of the Bible, the commandments. Leah's descendant, Caleb, who entered into the promised land. Centuries later, through her line would come Boaz, who redeems Ruth, Boaz, the great-grandfather of David. From her son Judah would come David, the second king of the nation of Israel, through whose lineage would come Jesus. And eventually, through her line, of course, before Jesus, was Mary and Joseph. Her sister Rachel would die in childbirth. And Leah raises the son that she died giving birth, Benjamin, through whom Paul, the guy who wrote 60% of the Bible as God spoke through him, would descend from the tribe of Benjamin. Her sister was buried in an obscure location as they were traveling. Now, Leah had no idea that her pain and her heartache would result in a priestly or kingly line. That's why it's so easy to judge what's happening to us right now in this short time short time span that we're here on this planet. And most often, and in the deepest pit, we need time and we need distance to see what God is really doing in our lives and a fuller picture. And we live in a culture that we want to know instantly, God, what are you doing now? And why are you doing this? And what next, God? And God says, wait a second, just time out, because I'm doing something that you cannot see. And we go back to that moment when Leah said, I will praise the Lord. In the midst of her rejection, rather than being bitter and angry, life is unfair, and gritting her, just being an angry woman. She had every right to be angry, being abused and used and rejected and called ugly. She had every right to hate everything about her life, but she came to a point where she praised the Lord. And God honored her in a powerful way. Here's the next lesson. The way you look is created by God. The Bible says that in your mother's womb, you were knit together by God. And when you slam your looks, when you tell yourself how bad looking you are, when looking in the mirror, you are slamming God's handiwork. God created you. And God loves you just the way you are. And here's the great news, and God says this over and over again, God never looks at just the outward appearance. We do, and usually it's the first thing that we judge. And Meg, you saw her pray just a few moments ago, and I love her testimony about when she came to know Christ. She was just a teenager, and she was popular, but she sat around in a Bible study initially that she had been invited to, and she went around the room, and she said, oh, he's cute, he's not, she's this, and judged her. And God spoke to her and said, you have done nothing but judge every one of these people, and all they have done is love you. It was the first step in Meg stepping into a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Our appearance fades and it deteriorates. But God loves the beauty on the inside in Jesus that blooms forever. Rachel had great beauty, but on the inside, if you read this true story, she was cunning. She could twist the truth. She was bitter. She was resentful. She hated her sister for having those sons. The physical beauty fades really quick, no matter how much Botox. Anybody know what I'm talking about? So, and you know, I love this verse. 1 Samuel says this, look, the Lord does not look at the things people look at. Isn't that good news? People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. God made something beautiful in Leah's life. So we kind of wrap it up just in Genesis 35. Look what it says. The sons of Leah were Reuben, the firstborn of Jacob, Simeon, Levi, Judah, Issachar, and Zebulun. And seven, if you include Benjamin, who was raised like her own. Here's the fourth lesson. You cannot know what God's plan will reveal. What would be revealed? We go all the way centuries later where you and I are given a glimpse of heaven. What heaven is like. People want to know, what's heaven like? Oh, the Bible has a lot to say about it. Revelation was written in some terms that people who are being persecuted of the day could understand, and you and I can understand that God wins. And he gives this picture in this window using language, trying to describe eternal things and infinite things and put it in finite times that you and I can understand. In Revelation 7, in John's revelation of Jesus, it's a revelation of Jesus. Right now, the names of Leah's six sons are listed among the 12 tribes of Israel, all listed. And the 12 tribes of Israel represent all those who are sealed with the love of God forever, for those that have stepped into a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. God used Leah in spite of her pain, in spite of her rejection, seeking for love in all the where? In all the wrong places. But she loved God, and God brought her through her mistakes. She loved Jacob to the end. And eventually, Leah won Jacob's heart. Now, Leah died before Jacob. And on his deathbed, we get this picture. Finally, Jacob got it. Because when Leah died, Jacob did something very powerful. Rachel had died in some obscure place, somewhere along a road as they were traveling, but not Leah. Leah was placed in the family graveyard, in a tomb of Abraham and Sarah and Isaac. And Leah was placed there. And in Genesis 49, verse 29, it says this, Jacob on his deathbed says, "Soon I will die and join my ancestors. Bury me with my father and grandfather in the cave in the field of Ephron, the Hittite." On his deathbed, Jacob said, "Bury me with Leah." Her legacy still stands today, and yours can also. No matter the rejection, the hurt, the pain, no matter what others think of you, God sees you as a beautiful daughter and son, created and knit together in your mother's womb. God loves you with an everlasting love. When you and I make a choice to serve Jesus, it's amazing what begins to happen as he changes us from the inside out. It's what happened to Leah. It's what can happen to you. Pray with me, would you? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you and praise you for this true story there so that we can learn not just these lessons, but so many. The destructive nature of bitterness and anger and resentment, and the incredible lessons that we learn of your grace and of your power and of your plan for our lives when we just choose to have candor and honesty before you, to choose to love you with all of our heart and our soul and our mind and our strength. And you will be with us. And no matter how deep the pit or dark the valley, you have a plan for our lives, you have a purpose, and you have hope in the midst of any pain, rejection, and heartache, and brokenness, because you are God, and we choose to love you. Jesus, you are with us. Now I want to pray, and I want you to just repeat this prayer right after me. Dear Jesus, I need you in my life, and I ask you to come into my heart and into my life. I need your power. I need your strength. I need your healing in my life. I've been hurt, rejected. I've experienced pain, but I thank you that you've put this incredible woman who left a legacy, even through all of her hurt and pain. And I want to do the same in you, Jesus. Help me to see a bigger plan than just me. But I yield and commit my life to you, Jesus. And I thank you for the hope that I have in you. In your name, I pray. And everyone said, amen. I told you, happy ending. It just gets better and better. You're going to see those names one day. And you're going to go, oh, I remember that story. Stretch out your hands, would you, and receive a blessing. Father, thank you on this weekend. We give you praise. We give you thanks. Like Leah finally came to that point with her son Judah. And would you bless your people and keep them and cause your face to shine upon them and give them your grace? Would you lift up the light of your countenance? Oh, and we thank you for your peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. I love you. We'll see you next weekend as we continue this series.
Thanks for joining us for our new series. I hope and I pray that God is moving in your family. And we're going to take the next several weeks and we're going to take a look at what God says about family, about how we do family, not only the relationships of in our lives, but also how we love one another, because sometimes our family can be the toughest. And so I'm excited to see what God is going to do, transform and grow your family in this season. But in the meanwhile, the church continues to be the church. I want to encourage you, join us online, gvchristian.com. If you go to /events, and you can find not only GV Marriage that wants to empower and equip and invest into your marriage because it's worth it, but you can also find our junior high and senior high camps that are available coming up soon, and more events that'll be happening on the horizon. Church, we're excited that God continues to move because you are the church and God continues to move in you. Have a great week, church. We'll see you next week.